सबसे पहले डॉक्टर अब्दुल समद अमोदी साहब लेक्चरर शोबे इस्लामिया यूनिवर्सिटी से ख्वाहिश है कि वो अपना मुहावरा पेश करें।
अस्सलामु अलैकुम व रहमतुल्लाहि व बरकातुहु। अल्हम्दुलिल्लाहि रब्बिल आलमीन व सलातु व सलाम अला अशरफिल मुरसलीन व सदकुल्लाजी। As I was discussing with Professor Mohsin Usmani Nadvi, that I would like to express my thoughts in English language. Because we have other eminent scholars here, they will be representing Urdu language as well, inshallah ta'ala. Mohsin Usmani is a well-known personality who uses his pen abundantly. And he used to write on current topics, the burning issues, and he used to show the solutions for the problems which the society is facing right now. It is the duty of a scholar to provide guidance to the society on such issues which are having no solution in the society, and people are watching towards them, that they are aware of Quran, they are aware of Hadith, they are well known with Seerah of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If they can guide us, we can have solution for our problems. As I said, Professor Usmani used to write on current topics. This topic is not a current topic. It is very old. Right from the era when Banu Umayya started their rule, this topic was under discussion. Various scholars used their knowledge, they presented their views, their pen, their words and their actions shows their eagerness, their curiosity and their thirst for betterment of the society, in particular the Muslim society. If we see carefully the revivalist movement, Ahya ad-Din, then we find Imam Abu Hanifa, who was the first man who started collective struggle to give solutions to the society. He gathered well-versed students, arranged a particular sort of setup, and he started codification of law, which was a duty of the state, but the state was failing in that. State was busy in catching, holding and killing those who were the supporters of Ali Raza Khan. So on private level we find that Imam Abu Hanifa started this collective research work. Later on, two of his great students, Imam Abu Yusuf and Imam Muhammad bin Hasan al-Shaybani, they both supported the system by their knowledge and their services. Abu Yusuf, being the Supreme Court Judge Qazi al-Quzza, he wrote one book for the support of Harun al-Rashid. Muhammad bin Hasan also wrote a book for the support of system, Kitab al-Anbar, Kitab al-Qaraj. We can see the rules and regulations for taxation and revenue generation, which could help the government to earn wealth through allowed and permitted means. Later on we see this system was carried by other scholars to give problem, to give solutions for the problems which the society was facing on their particular eras, on their particular times. For example, if we see Imam Ibn Taymiyyah, the great scholar, about whom people used to see and read in the books, regarding any statement, if Ibn Taymiyyah says this is a hadith, that will be a hadith. If Ibn Taymiyyah declared this is not a hadith, people used to accept that yes, Ibn Taymiyyah declared this is not a hadith. Such a scholar who was having the power of pen, but when time came, he kept his pen, took the sword, participated in jihad, in qital, against the Mongols who attacked the Muslim state. By his writings and by his action, he showed that it is a duty of scholars to come front and participate in solving the issues of the society. Moving ahead, we find it was Ibn Taymiyyah who was the first man who wrote on fiqh al-akhliyyah. Before his time, Muslims were dominant. Muslims were ghalib in the society. But after the attack of Mongols, Muslims became subjects, they became mahkum, and it was a time when Muslims were in need of a constitution which could protect them as minorities, which could protect their personal life. After him, his two students, Ibn Jawzi, Ibn Kathir, also supported the views, and they wrote in their books. Aram al-Mawtin, Ibn Jawzi, in that book, mentions various aspects. Then if we see India, our native land, even in India we find many scholars who supported the system and tried their level best to rectify the Muslim community. Waliullah Mosque is there, me and his entire family. This man was a great man. His services, we cannot forget him. Translated Quran in Persian, and his family members, later on his progeny, translated it in Urdu. There were many misconceptions regarding Muslim history, and Waliullah Mosque Dehlvi tried to solve those issues and present the right scenario in his book, Izalatul Faqr. We see Sheikh Ahmad Sarhindi, we see Ismail Shaheed, Hudayl Amar, and later on, as Professor Tha was mentioning, various scholars took their pen, wrote on burning issues. During the era when Ottoman Empire was under decline, when Khilafat al-Usmaniya was facing decline, we saw various scholars, they presented their views in protecting Muslims and giving them new zeal, new power of joining together and having a good stand in the world. Jamaluddin Afghani, Muhammad Abdu, Rashid Rida, then Hasanul Banna, then Qutub Shaheed, same time here in India, Sayyid Abul Alam Maududi. After him, Maulana Ali Mian Nadvi. Professor Mohsin Usmani Nadvi is from the same chain of scholars which always took their pen and wrote on political issues. We see Nahdlatul Ulama never declared politics as Shajaratul Mamnu'a. Various scholars from Nahdwa, they wrote abundantly on politics. Shibli Romani during his era used to write on political issues. His great student Allama Suleiman Nadvi used to write on political issues. Abdul Bari Nadvi Sahab, professor in Usmania, he used to write on political issues. But we don't know from where a thought came into Muslim community that politics is a different thing, religion is a different thing, we should not gather them. We have to look these two things separately. This view, this idea came from Roman ideology. It was Romans who adopted the Greek civilization. Later they became the Roman civilization. And under their impact, under their influence, Muslims too accepted their views. Before, never ever any scholar declared that politics, siyasat, siyadat, khiyadat, has a different subject. It was a part of religion. We got Islam, complete system of life, Deen al-Kamil. When Deen is Kamil, then politics will also be included. Without politics, it will be incomplete. My two more sayings on which I would like to conclude is that in this book, Professor Mohsin Usmani Nadvi mentioned the objectives of a state. Normally, we used to find different political systems carrying on their rule on various geographical areas. They got their own objectives, maqasid. Mohsin Usmani Nadvi mentioned in his book that a Muslim state got various objectives. The first one is that state should provide justice to everyone. If state is successful in providing justice, then in result of that, peace will prevail. The other aspect as an objective, as a purpose of state, mentions that it is the responsibility of state and the ruler and his council to promote virtues, ma'ruf. It is the duty and responsibility of state, the ruler and his council, and all those Muslims who got certain kind of authorities in the society, they have to stop, prevent and finish munkar. Then establishment of salah, then the system of zakah, then security and preservation of akhlaq, then propagation of Islam, religion, Ishad. These are various duties and responsibilities which became the purpose, the objectives of a state. In simple words, Muslim state will be a welfare state where every citizen, every subject will gain their welfare. He mentions in detail about Maqasid al-Sharia, the high values which will be considered during legalization and process of formation of rules. Protection of life, protection of wealth, protection of religion, protection of human progeny, protection of knowledge, and moreover, Dr. Saab mentioned in his book, there are 10 prerequisites. If those prerequisite conditions are fulfilled, then only the system will be a Muslim system, Islamic system. If those 10 basic conditions are not fulfilled, that system could be anything, but it could not be Islam. The first thing, no person can become ruler by his own wish and will. The second thing, council will decide what to do, not the will and wish of a ruler. It's not dictatorship. It is the rule of council, Shura. Third thing, he mentioned that it is a duty to promote Maruf. It is a duty to uproot evil. He mentioned there, more ahead, it is a duty of a ruler to carry on his system and mechanism for promotion of peace and propagation, not creating disturbances, not creating havoc. Present era, present system, we find various rulers which are seen by the world as Muslims, but they are not representing Islam as well. They are representing their own families. Betterly we can say them a royal family, betterly we can say their system as monarchy, but not as Khilafat, as Islamic system. Nearly century we are going to pass. We lost our Khilafat. We don't have caliphate system. We don't have any ruler Khalifa with us. We don't have this Shura'i concept, council system. We don't have participation of citizens in welfare of the government and the state. Whereas in Islamic system, citizens got the right to criticize over government. Citizens got the right to criticize over the ruler. Various examples he mentioned, various evidences and facts he mentioned. Once a person moves ahead with this book, he will find that really this book is an eye-opener. It will provide us the guidance for the present era, how to carry on our scheme to achieve the Khilafat in the present time. I would like to conclude on a request that I found this book much helpful on academic ground. If this Urdu book is translated into English, a major population of the world could get benefit from that book. So if Dr. Saab is allowing, I am presenting my services. I will render it into English so that a major part of the population get benefited from that book. And I would like to try to add that book as a reference book in the syllabus of Usmani University Islamic Studies so that the students can get the right purview, right concept of Muslims' rules and regulations regarding carrying on the political system. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
Thank you.
MashaAllah. Dr. Abdul Samad Mohdi Sahab, lecturer.